We are now going to move from the report out of the working group into some more concrete case, if you will, presentations. We've heard a lot this morning about how one frames, what could be the endpoint, what do we need to do preclinically, what are assays that we can measure, what are we really going to say are relevant endpoints, both as biomarkers or perhaps clinically as we go forward. And we've just had a really fascinating discussion on informed consent and ethics and how do we understand people and what people are being told. One of the most interesting and challenging places is in pediatrics and in maternal and child health. And so we're going to go there now. Deborah is going to come and present first on the CDER research in the maternal pediatric setting, the overall research agenda from IMPACT, and then we'll move to Ellen Chadwick, who's going to talk about P1115. Correct? Okay, Deb, if you'll start.
Well, I want to thank Veronica for giving pediatrics some time in this symposium. And certainly pediatric CDER research agenda is loaded with regulatory issues, ethical issues, and vulnerable populations. But in the spirit of moving forward and to use some of the terminology discussed this morning, the pediatric CDER research agenda is being built on in the context of moving forward, building on a research agenda platform that already exists, proof of principle, and then with considerations for moving in an ethical framework. And to quote Romas, we are going to walk before we run with this agenda. So I do want to start with the numbers, and the numbers are here. There are 3.3 million children living with HIV. And what you see on this slide are new HIV infections, and these are the updated figures from UNAIDS in 2012. So there were 260,000 new infections in infants, despite our significant progress made in prevention to mother-child transmission. And the deaths in 2012, there were 210,000 deaths. But what's important about this slide is really the numbers showing 52% reduction in new infections from 2001. And it's important to point out that this remarkable success is really stems from a research agenda that started over 20 years ago in prevention of mother-to-child transmission. So the first studies to show that antiretroviral drugs indeed can prevent HIV infection was done in a maternal infant model in which women in the 1990s enrolled in trials of use of AZT during pregnancy. There was no knowledge about use of AZT in pregnancy or even to infants. And the basis for the PACTG-076 trial was really based on animal model data showing that AZT could indeed prevent transmission in an animal model. And so in this spirit of using new drugs and new approaches to prevent infection in children, we began our pediatric HIV CDER agenda. And in terms of the numbers, there have actually been about 14,000 women infant pairs enrolled in clinical trials of antiretroviral drugs to prevent transmission in, I think, 18 clinical trials in 16 countries, so not including trials of prevention of breast milk transmission. Now, it's like HIV-infected adults, a reservoir for HIV in resting memory CD4 T cells, the major barrier to CDER is established very early in infection. And we don't quite know what the window of opportunity here is for intervention to prevent blockade in formation of reservoirs. But we've received an initial clue from the Mississippi trial, which I'll briefly review in the context of this talk. But what you see on this slide is what we do know from studying bioreservoirs in children. And we have been able to successfully conduct these trials of reservoirs in children enrolled in clinical trials. And we do know that there is age-dependent differences in terms of the size of a reservoir. So in other words, in children who are controlled late, so after a year of age, the reservoir is larger than those who control viremia by 1 year of age. And our standard antiretroviral treatment approach is all HIV-infected infants are treated irrespective of viral load and CD4 counts because our early antiretroviral treatment is life-saving. So again, this is sort of building upon a platform where antiretroviral drugs are standardly used for prevention with diagnosis. It's a global standard to start antiretroviral treatment. So we don't really see this as a big jump ahead for our deviation from standard of CDER. So what I do want to say is that the perinatal HIV infection model certainly provides a unique opportunity to assess immediate ART and cure. First of all, the timing of HIV exposure is known, and this is really unprecedented for the perinatal field. Early reservoir formation may be restricted under routine antiretroviral prophylaxis that are used to prevent mother-to-child transmission. So in other words, every infant who's born to an infected mom receives antiretroviral prophylaxis. The number of drugs that are used is based on the risk assessment in that infant, which is directly correlated with maternal viral load and the extent to which viral suppression has occurred. And furthermore, the unique characteristics of the infant immune system, it's underdeveloped, it's tolerogenic, and this may promote marked restriction in reservoir size if antiretroviral treatment is given early. Now, in the case of the Mississippi child, this is, most of you know about this case, is sustained HIV remission. We've turned this remission to take into account the fact that the follow-up is still quite short. It's at 2 years now post antiretroviral treatment discontinuation. But this case highlights exactly what we're seeing in the United States, where there's still about 200 cases per year in the United States of HIV-infected infants, and also in resource-constrained settings where women are not identified as infected. So in other words, there are high proportion of women presenting in labor who do not know they're infected, so there's no opportunity to prevent infection. And while our goal is to prevent infection, and that really still is our goal, it's not to cure, it's really to prevent infection. For those infants who fail antiretroviral prophylaxis, to be able to offer very early antiretroviral treatment is life-saving, even if it does not achieve cure. So for the Mississippi child, what we have here is a child, as you see in black circles, multiple visits of plasma, detectable plasma viral load, and with to the extent to which control of viremia occurred by 3 weeks of age. And this may be a critical time frame. We've shown in a study, an impact study, P1030, the time to undetectable viral load was really a critical feature in terms of it correlating with the reservoir size of 2 years of age. So we may begin to pay attention to time to undetectable viremia as one biomarker assessment on eventual reservoir size. So in the case of the Mississippi child, we can say if you want to say VSOT, it would be V less than 0.6, SOT for up to 2 years of age. Now, implementing immediate ART for HIV cure research is actually quite scalable. We can build on existing PMTCT programs globally. And so this has public health implications with respect to rollout of this strategy, if it were indeed to work. And there's added value to this, even if we don't cure HIV infection in infants. This provides an opportunity to focus on early infant diagnosis, potential to enhance identification of and treatment of infected infants, and to promote retention in care and prolong lives. So our CURE scientific agenda is built on the framework of the first goal is really the low-hanging fruit for pediatrics, which is to evaluate very early antiretroviral treatment to reduce viral reservoirs in the units. And then there are a large proportion of our children are living with chronic infection with readily detectable reservoirs that are quite dynamic, to look at the effects of immunomodulatory agents and vaccines on these reservoirs, and then to elucidate the relationships between viral reservoirs and the developing immune system. And so our approaches to cure is similar to adults with a few exceptions with respect to latency reversing agents. What you see on this slide in the text boxes are the number of capsules and protocols that we have that are already rolled out in the field and some that are in development. So to summarize, HIV-infected children, the need for a cure research agenda that occurs in parallel with adult studies is HIV-infected children, like adults, face a lifetime of antiretroviral treatment. It's now estimated that the lifetime of an infected child could actually be 30 or more years. There is medication fatigue, antiretroviral toxicities, and importantly, stigma and social factors that promote non-adherence in this population with self-directed treatment interruption that occurs on a regular basis. The developing immune system certainly provides an opportunity for very early and early treatment, along with thymic reserve that sets the pediatric infectious disease HIV infection model apart from the adult program. And there's clear scientific rationale for simultaneous conduct of these studies towards cure or sustained remission in children. But these approaches have to be guided by strong scientific reasoning with special attention to the risk, benefits, and false expectations that have been discussed this morning. I do want to acknowledge our HIV Cure Scientific Committee, which continues to work very hard and diligently towards moving our agenda forward. And I'll turn the platform over to Ellen Chadwick, who's one of the co-chairs for the IMPACT P1115 trial, a follow-up of the Mississippi child. Thank you.
I'd like to thank the forum for inviting us to present P1115, and I'm presenting on behalf of my co-chairs, Mark Cotton and Yvonne Bryson, as well as our team. So P1115 is entitled Very Early Intensive Treatment of Infected Infants to Achieve HIV Remission. We've already got the remission term as opposed to the cure term, and this is a proof of concept study. So the HIV remission reported in a U.S.-born child treated with a three-drug ARV regimen by 31 hours of life for HIV exposure from an untreated maternal infection really got us focused on what we could do for these very, very high-risk infants. And there are emerging data that very early therapy during acute infection in both adults and children quantitatively modifies HIV persistence. So we're working on the hypothesis that very early ART in neonates with in utero HIV infection may permit long-term control of HIV replication off ART and leads to HIV remission, which we have used as a working definition of HIV RNA below the limit of detection for 48 weeks following ART cessation. Our primary objective is to assess HIV remission as defined among HIV-infected infants who initiate ART within 48 hours of birth. And we have a number of secondary objectives, the first of which is safety of very early ART in neonates. The second is pharmacokinetics in neonates and young infants, of which we never have enough data. And this is looking at both nevirapine at a treatment dose, which is higher than the current dose that is used for prophylaxis of perinatal transmission, and the PK of lopinavir exposures when dosed with nevirapine in these young infants. We are also interested in the relationship between the time to reach plasma HIV RNA below the limit of detection and achievement of virologic and immunologic criteria for ART cessation, as well as the extent of HIV persistence in infants who do achieve HIV remission, and finally, immune activation and the host and viral determinants, including maternal factors and HIV-specific immune responses that are associated with HIV remission. So this is a four-step study. Step one is the initiation of intensive ART for high-risk infants while awaiting HIV test results. So in other words, these are infants that will be enrolled before we know whether they have in utero infection. And if they are infected, they will enter step two. And if they are uninfected, they will exit the study after 4 weeks. Step two is continued intensive ART for confirmed infected infants with monitoring to determine the eligibility for cessation of ART between ages 2 and 4 years. Step three will be ART cessation with monitoring for viral rebound, and these children will be followed through 5 years of age. And step four would be ART reinitiation for children who experience viral rebound, again, being followed until 5 years of age. And the way this will play out is the cohort one is the high-risk infant group. And these are infants of unknown HIV status whose mother received no ARVs during pregnancy. And so, in other words, these are women that come in unknown to be HIV infected or out of care. These infants have to be picked up within 48 hours of birth and enrolled within 48 hours of birth. And in order to generate enough in utero infected infants, which by definition is a positive birth PCR within 48 hours of age, we believe that we need to enroll up to 320 formula feeding infants and up to 120 breastfeeding infants in order to generate 16 formula feeding in utero infected infants and 6 breastfed confirmed infected infants. So that's the cohort one group. Cohort two, we're calling the early treated infants. And these are infants who have at least one positive HIV test and initiated ART within 48 hours of birth outside of the study. So these are children who are being followed by clinicians who have made a clinical decision to initiate preemptive therapy within 48 hours of birth before they're known to be infected, and then when the test comes back positive that they have an utero infection, then they will be given the opportunity to enroll in the study. And we are hoping to enroll up to 16 formula feeding infants in cohort two and up to 16 breastfed infants. So the cohort one infants will enroll before knowing that they're infected, and the cohort two infants will enroll after demonstrated that they have in utero infection. And then in the cohort one infants who have negative birth PCRs, who do not have intrauterine infection, they will exit the study at 4 weeks and resume standard HIV perinatal prophylaxis in their country of origin. The drug regimens in step one are two NRTIs and nevirapine at a treatment dose as opposed to what has been used as the prophylaxis dose. This is a significantly higher dose that has been modeled based on population PK data, and this is the dose that we believe will be necessary to provide appropriate levels for treatment as opposed to prophylaxis. In step two, for the infected infants, we will start with the same regimen as in step one, and after 2 weeks of age or at least 42 weeks postmenstrual age, we will add lopinavir-ritonavir to that regimen. We can't add this earlier due to the potential toxicity that is known with this agent at the very young ages and in the premature infants. And then the children will remain on four drugs until they have had an RNA below the level of detection for at least 12 weeks, which we are estimating is going to be roughly about 6 months of age. And they will drop the nevirapine at that time and go to three-drug therapy with lopinavir as the backbone. Step three, when they meet criteria for ART cessation, we will stop ARVs in that select group of individuals. And in step four, if they have viral rebound, they will restart the same therapy they were on in step two. Our eligibility criteria for the cohort one patients, the mothers, have to have presumed or confirmed HIV infection at the time of enrollment, and they may not have received any ARVs during the current pregnancy. They may potentially have been treated in the past, but importantly, nothing during this pregnancy at all. The infants enroll at under 48 hours of age, must be at least 34 weeks gestational age at birth, and no other clinically significant diseases. The step two infants in cohort one, in other words, those that start in cohort one, step one, and move to cohort two when they're proved to be infected, just have to have evidence of infection. The mothers in cohort two are somewhat different because they have been potentially treated during pregnancy, but they did not have virologic control. So it's a much more open population for the mothers. Infants also have to be greater than 34 weeks gestational age, but may enroll up to 10 days of age as opposed to within 2 days of age with the cohort one patients. These infants have to had at least one positive nucleic acid test for infection within 48 hours of birth. And again, they must have been started on ART within 48 hours of birth by their clinician and continued daily since that time. The virologic monitoring in step two for the infected infants will be very intense, initially on a weekly basis and then spreading out over time. And we are looking for infants to drop their viral load below the level of detection by week 24, or then they must exit the study because we do not expect that they will be good candidates for possible treatment cessation. For those infants that make that first 24-week cutoff, after week 24, they must have sustained viral suppression, and anyone with confirmed rebound would exit the study at that time. And infants whose viral load remains suppressed through week 84 of step 2 will then be evaluated for the possible entry into step 3 ART cessation. So to get into step 3, they have to be on study at least 96 weeks, which will correlate to about 2 years of age. They will have to have been off the breast for at least 6 weeks for the breastfeeding cohort. And they have to achieve a viral load less than the level of detection by week 24 and no confirmed viral rebound thereafter. And then there are more strict lab criteria to be eligible to stop ART. They must have 2 consecutive negative antibody tests by at least a third generation ELISA, 8 weeks apart, 2 consecutive negative HIV DNA tests at least 8 weeks apart, no detectable HIV RNA, and a CD4 count that is normal for age. In those children that do progress to step 3, they will stop ART, and then we will intensely monitor their RNA-PCR. And if there is a documented or confirmed RNA over the level of detection on 2 consecutive tests, patients will restart therapy. And then they will be monitored. That will be step 4, and they'll be closely monitored for viral resuppression. Now, one very important piece of this study is safety. And what we are trying to do is maximize safety for the parts of the protocol that is outside the standard of normal practice in caring for infected infants. So we want to investigate treatment dosing of nevirapine for the first 2 weeks of life. Once they've met that 2-week time point, they go over to standard nevirapine dosing. So that's a very limited period of time. We also are paying very close attention to these infants being on very intensive 4-drug ART until about 6 months of age. And then, of course, we will be monitoring them very carefully during the time of ART cessation. We do have a clinical management committee, which is a subset of the protocol team, which will regularly review clinical and laboratory toxicity data reports and respond to any issues that come up with subjects on study. And we will have a study monitoring committee, which is independent of the protocol team, which will review study data approximately every 6 months, looking at primary safety outcome data and the permanent discontinuations of ARVs for safety reasons. We also have guidelines for an ad hoc SMC review of ART cessation, and we will look at each of the cohorts separately. And if we find that 10 out of the first 10 children in a treatment cohort who sees ART will have a viral rebound, then we will reevaluate the ART cessation step and suspend it in that cohort until it's been reevaluated. If 5 children in a cohort do not resuppress HIV within 6 weeks after ART reinitiation, this is step 4, then again, we will reevaluate the ART cessation step. And after any ART suspension, the SMC will be convened to evaluate future direction of the protocol. So I will be happy to answer any questions about the protocol, or do you want to do that as part of the panel?
Are there any clarifying questions? I'm afraid we might get into a lot of detail, but Dan, let's do a couple of clarifying questions, but then I think we'll bring the panel up as well.
Just a quick question. So for because you're permitting women who may have had prior ART use to come into the study, how will you deal with the issue of potential nevirapine resistance? I recognize that resistance testing would greatly complicate the logistics of the study, but that could be an issue since you're just starting with a 3-drug nevirapine regimen.
Yes, that's an excellent question, and we've thought a lot about that. The problem is we don't really have a lot of other treatment options, and we're hoping that perhaps if we intervene early enough that we will be able to override, if you will, some degree of nevirapine resistance if we get them suppressed, but it's a big concern. When more drugs become available, we hope to roll over into other drug classes that will be available to use instead of nevirapine. Yes?
Really quick. Your safety monitoring board, I forget what initials you used. How often do they actually review that data? Once a week, once a month?
Well, actually, it's going to be on an ongoing basis. We'll probably start either weekly or every other week and see how that goes. But there's always going to be somebody on the safety monitoring committee that is on call for every single day, so that if anything comes up, we can pull the group together to evaluate.
Mark will take yours as the last clarified question.
This is a real quickie. How frequently will the RNA be monitored during the suspension of ART? You said intense monitoring, but you didn't say how intense.
Yeah, so we will start actually by doing weekly monitoring. And so we'll do 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, and then we'll start spacing it out. Thank you.
Thank you. If I could now ask the members of the panel to come up. Thank you. What I'd like to do is to just ask the members of the panel as we go down, particularly for those who haven't spoken yet, to introduce themselves and make some comments regarding both the general, if you will, pediatric sustained remission agenda, shall we call it, rather than cure, and also if there are any comments around the protocol. And Linda, can we start with you, please?
Sure. Well, I think that as Debbie Bernkrant said earlier this morning, the FDA and Division of Antivirals is very interested in any kind of HIV remission cure research, and we do want to be actively involved in helping to develop these protocols and develop viable endpoints for studies. And my interest is pediatrics, so I'm particularly interested in carrying on the discussion of these protocols that are being developed in as early a stage as possible. So I'm glad to be here to start that discussion.
Mark, I think we'll move along to you since Ellen presented. We'll hear some new voices and then we'll open it up.
Thank you very much. So I'm Mark Cotton. I'm a pediatrician from Tigerberg near Cape Town. I was one of the investigators for the SHER study, which I'd just like to briefly talk about now. It was a two-center study that evaluated infants under 12 weeks of age and with good CD4 percentages, and asked the question, should you treat according to what was standard of care at the time, which is wait and watch how sick, if they get sick or if the CD4 count goes down, or treat immediately, and for those that were treated to interrupt therapy at 40 weeks or 96 weeks. The idea was that if it worked, it would be easily implementable into public practice, in that they would start immediately and then they would stop at the first or the second birthday. And the decisions to restart treatment were not based on viral loads. They were based on CD4 percentages and counts. The first part of the study showed that early treatment was life-saving, and it changed treatment guidelines for children worldwide to early treatment, which at that stage was regarded as under 12 weeks of age. In the study, it was actually 7 weeks of age. And so that became a firm guideline. In terms of the interruption part of the treatment, it went remarkably well. And at the end of the study, which lasted 6 years, the deferred group still did significantly worse than the two early treatment and interruption arms. At the end of the study, there was approximately 30% of the children had not yet restarted therapy, and the difference in time off treatment was approximately 30 weeks in the ART40 and approximately 70 weeks in the ART96, with some diminution of of clinical events in the ART 96. So it, you know, it seemed to work pretty well, actually. The next point that I want to make is that the Mississippi baby has changed what we regard as early treatment. And clearly, you know, this needs to start much earlier on the first day or two of life. And one of the really important points about P1115 is that even if no infant is cured, they're going to be identified very, very early, and they're going to be retained in care, and hopefully they're going to do well. So in terms of what happens to in the first 4 to 6 weeks of life with HIV-infected babies, it's a black hole. We just don't know. There's very little data, and the data that we do have suggests that there's a huge loss, a huge attrition in the first couple of weeks of life. The standard until now in high prevalence settings such as sub-Saharan Africa is a single PCR at 6 weeks of age, which we think is going to be too late. So a huge benefit of this protocol is going to be to advance the way infants are routinely looked after in the PMTCT programs.
Hi, I'm Seema Shah. I work at the Department of Bioethics at the NIH, and also I work closely with many at the Division of AIDS. It's a pleasure to be here and to see many people who've been on these calls with me, who I formerly only knew as disembodied voices. It's nice to see you all, and I've really appreciated working with you. So I just wanted to make a couple of comments about P1115 that reflect the sort of ethical considerations that went into designing this trial, and try to generalize a little bit from those considerations to the general issue of pediatric HIV remission research, or whatever we want to call it, or, and also to think about the adult studies as well. So I think what everyone has said so far is right, that this isn't really entirely new ethical terrain. There's a lot of wisdom out there that we can draw upon to figure out how to proceed. And the principles that always guide us still guide us here. So we still need to think about minimizing risk, enhancing benefit, respecting autonomy, and ensuring sufficient social value to justify risk. But what's really challenging here is that there are difficult ethical trade-offs involved that are maybe a little bit unique or slightly different than we've seen in the past, where each, as we're thinking about the different choices we make, we have to grapple with them, but we can't quite get to easy answers. This is a clear way to proceed. So if you look at the design of P1115, there's this choice of population. Do you start with women who are at very high risk of infection, of transmitting infection to their infants, or with women who have been already engaged in the care continuum, who are at much lower risk of transmitting HIV? And there you have this trade-off where typically we think of women at high risk of transmission as being more vulnerable. We think that they might not know as much about the system, and they might also present so late in pregnancy that they don't have a lot of time to process the informed consent procedure that we've all been talking about at length. But those women present the best risk-benefit trade-off for their infants, right? Because their infants are at higher risk of transmission, they're more likely to be infected and more likely to benefit from the interventions that are being offered. So I think that choice is a difficult choice, but is, I think, the right choice was made here to proceed with the higher risk-benefit ratio. There are other types of choices you could choose to either initiate early when you're not entirely sure of HIV infection, or wait until you're more certain. But as many have discussed, that trade-off might mean starting too late to actually achieve HIV remission. So I think these types of trade-offs really do suggest that the only way forward is to engage with the relevant stakeholders, to think very carefully about the ethical considerations, to make a choice and to justify that choice in the protocol. And there might only be a range of things that we think are ethically acceptable, but there probably won't be one right and easy answer. So I look forward to the discussions, and I don't want to keep anybody from those discussions or from your lunch any longer.
Thank you. I'm going to open it now to questions from the floor. Dan.
One comment and a question. I think the study is very well designed, and I think that as with acute intervention studies in recent HIV infection in adults, the big advantage here is that what you're doing is giving treatment very early, and then maybe you'll have an interruption depending on what happens. So, right, I think that really helps to balance the risks here perfectly, because there's no absolute commitment to interruption, and it depends a lot on it's Bayesian in that sense, right? It depends a lot on what happens, and you can also readjust your thinking over the course of the trial before you actually get to the moment of interruption. So that was the comment. The question I have is about the frequency of monitoring. And, you know, this comes out of the experience that Tim Henrich had with the study that that we were doing. So we thought we were being very conservative by having patients be monitored weekly for the first 12 weeks. And then if that nothing had happened, we could go to every other week. And it turned out we were wrong. Now, granted that the stem cell transplant setting is different, but maybe not terribly different from very early initiation of therapy, be it in the perinatal transmission setting or an acute HIV, you know, horizontal transmission in adults, that we don't know how long it'll be before people rebound, if they are going to. And what happened with us is after the first patient rebounded, we went back to the second patient had just gone to every other week monitoring because he was already a few months ahead. And we went back to doing every week monitoring, and we still missed the rebound. The patient came in with symptoms of acute infection, and that's when we retested. So I realize it's clearly burdensome on the patients as their blood volume issues, although it's not a huge blood volume for just the virus load test. But it's something to consider. When is the appropriate moment to transition? I would suggest maybe you want to be a little bit more conservative than when you start spacing them out. And I was wondering whether in the SHARE trial there was what was learned about the events around the interruption. I know that you weren't doing frequent virus load monitoring, but were there clinical events? Were there symptoms of acute infection? Was any of that captured, or was that not built into the trial?
Thanks. It's an important question. So. Firstly, we didn't notice anything, but we weren't looking for it. So the after interruption, the next visit was in week 8 when there was a symptom check and they were examined, and subsequently it became a three monthly visit. So we were not looking, and my knowledge of the acute retroviral syndrome in children is that it can be quite subtle. And this is from work done in Kenya and in West Africa, pretty subtle, but, you know, so we would have missed something like that, unfortunately, and I really regret that.
Let's see, Mark Harrington and then Larry Fox.
Yeah, so the mother didn't get any ARVs and the baby's eligible. Why wouldn't you, if a baby's positive, if a baby has HIV DNA or RNA at within 48 hours, why, regardless of what the mother took, why wouldn't you enroll that baby into a study like this?
Thank you. You know, we had a hard time deciding exactly what patient population to look at, and the primary objective was to try to replicate the Mississippi experience, which was an untreated mother. So that's our primary focus group. So in terms of starting a mother who has received some treatment, the infant of a mother who has received some treatment, they would be eligible for cohort 2. So cohort 1 okay. is only for these sort of pure Mississippi type babies, right. And cohort 2 would be eligible for those infants.
Thanks, Doc.
Larry, and then John Mellers, and then the back mic.
So this is by way of clarification question for the 1115 protocol. I noticed that you've been stressing over and over and over again, infected in utero, meaning a positive nucleic acid test from a specimen taken within 48 hours. Most kids are not found to have been infected in utero. Mm-hmm. They're infected intrapartum.
Correct.
So that I can understand why it would get really tricky designing entry criteria to include everybody. Mm-hmm. Obviously, if you were negative in your 48-hour specimen and you could wait that long to begin, which you don't want to do, but you were then positive in a specimen drawn at 1 week, you would be able to say, okay, now you're an intrapartum, you're part of the majority, and we can also study you. Given those caveats, I realize it's tough to design these things. How would you extrapolate what you learn from the study you've designed to include the majority of infants that don't show up until 1 week?
Yeah, that's an excellent point. And honestly, when we started designing the trial, we planned to include the intrapartum infected infants because we all agree that that's a very important group of infants to study. The problem is it just got to be continually bigger and bigger, and we've been asked to sort of focus our study primarily on this particular replication of the Mississippi experience and the in utero infection. So we're all hoping that we will then have perhaps a subsequent trial that would capture those infants as well, but it just wasn't within our purview at this point.
Ellen, I know you've been asked this question many, many times, but I'd like to ask it again. I think I know what the answer is. There's technology available to diagnose HIV infection within 8 hours. Mm. Why did you elect to treat 350 infants to identify 26 eligible who were infected, as opposed to and mitigate the risk of antiretroviral exposure in those versus honing in on those who are actually infected?
Yeah, and that would be a wonderful way to do it, and honestly, that's a better way to do it. The problem is that most clinical scenarios are not set up to actually make a diagnosis that rapidly, and I think if any of the providers that we've talked to and we've surveyed that's going to enroll into this study have told us that their typical turnaround time for nucleic acid tests is up to 2 weeks. And so people are just not set up to get these rapid tests. Actually, Mark and I were just talking about the fact that some of the point of care testing is being tested in his site in South Africa. You can elaborate on that, but obviously that's going to be a great boon to identifying specifically which patients are going to be best suited for the trial.
Came from an overall transmission rate of 5-6%. And Larry, that's why we excluded the intrapartum group, because with 3-drug prophylaxis, we'll probably prevent infections in most of those kids. So we'd have to study a lot more kids to identify a few infected intrapartum. So as part of a proof of principle, and to get back to Dan's point, you know, we're not sure nevirapine is going to work, but that's the only drug we have available. In fact, the reason we were able to roll out P11-15 so quickly is what we had in development was a protocol to use raltegravir. And so we're, you know, an integrase inhibitor. So we're in the process of getting the PK data for an integrase inhibitor. So there are many obstacles, actually, P11-15 with using a nevirapine-based regimen, resistance being one of them.
So I think it'll be an ongoing dialogue, but I'd really press some of the major diagnostic companies for their commitment to such a program to diagnose infants within 48 hours. My conversations is that they're willing to do it. They're willing to provide the machinery and the kits to do it.
And many of us in this room, I'm looking at Veronica, have been involved in really trying to facilitate and have early infant diagnosis. I know that UNICEF, UNAIDS, and others are really very interested in that. So it may be, you know, when you think about facilitating dialogue and where you can work, I would think that reaching out to see if there's a way that you can use this protocol and or put it in sites that are being identified now to do early infant diagnosis. We have Beck, microphone, then Joe.
My question is, can you please extrapolate on the various considerations for blood draw volumes for pediatric HIV cure trials?
Yes, that's obviously a very big concern that we've had, and we have very careful adherence to NIH guidelines on the maximum blood volumes allowed. And one of the constraints is that we have to have certain tests need to be done in order to, for instance, document that the child is infected. So we're doing everything we can to use the smallest blood volumes available, and we've prioritized all the laboratory tests so that the maximum allowable blood draw is not exceeded.
We have a trio from UNC here. We've got Susan, Joe, and Gail. So, Joe, you were up first, then Susan, then Gail, if that's okay.
Yeah. So, this seems to me right along the Jeremy Sugarman's discussion earlier. So you're going to treat 300 plus infants with at least potentially two or more weeks of an experimental dose of nevirapine, who don't need it. To find 6 or 22 that have the outside chance of benefiting with the cure. So that, I mean, that's really, this seems to me like a pretty big ethical dilemma. I wondered what the discussions were for that.
Well, you're right that this is something that we talked a lot about. I think the one potential benefit is that that's very enhanced prophylaxis in addition to intervention. So it's not without some potential benefit. But because of our difficulties with making early diagnoses, we didn't know how else to get in treatment in time to potentially limit the reservoirs, which is really what this is all about. And so that's a real risk benefit discussion that we've had.
Seema, and then maybe Susan wants to talk about early diagnosis.
So I did want to say that some of these issues are discussed in a recent paper in the Lancet Infectious Diseases, not to toot my own horn, but I just wanted to mention it because I have several co-authors on it who've also thought about these issues. And I think, you know, initially one of the other questions was, shouldn't you start with a less vulnerable population of women who are at lower risk of transmission to their infants? And that question would have exposed even more infants to drugs who may not have been infected. The other issue is you can't ex ante identify who's infected, right? So to the extent you can, you implement it. If you have this large trial, multiple sites where you're trying to get capacity built up, but you can't quite do it in time, then you may have constraints on you where the generalizability of the results is also another consideration. So I think there are a lot of challenges in figuring out how to balance the risk-benefit ratio. But when you think about the risk-benefit profile for a mother-infant pair entering this study, it does seem to me that there's a prospect of benefit for these infants.
Okay, Susan and then Gail.
Yeah, so to get back to the early infant diagnosis and everything, the minute I heard about the Mississippi baby, well, first of all, let me backtrack and say that Veronica and I have been working on point of care. Yeah. 15 years ago, Veronica and I worked with the forum on point of care viral load assays and early infant diagnosis. So the minute I heard about, and I'm still kind of working on that, and so when I heard about the Mississippi baby, I contacted all of them and I said, what do you have? Everyone is going to need this. They want to diagnose their baby within 48 hours, you know, within 12 hours, within, you know, as soon as we can. And the problem is regulatory. And anyone in industry knows that you can't talk to anyone in the United States because you'll get in trouble with the FDA. And so they'll go to South Africa, they'll go to Kenya, they'll do, you know, trials there and everything. And so we want it. Everyone knows about it, John. It just is the assays are there, they're in the pipeline, but they continue to have problems with one thing or another. They are continually redesigning things. They find out that maybe whole blood doesn't work, and so they have to go back and do some sort of a plasma separation step. And so, and then the other thing that's very fluid right now is that various companies are acquiring some of this technology for themselves, and then that kind of stops the pipeline moving while the lawyers get all the language right, and then, I mean, it just goes on and on. But believe me, we are certainly looking into it because it's so important.
Wow. I think this is just a fascinating panel. Thank you all. And I'm particularly happy that Mark Cotton, whose paper I'd read, the report on that study that you are working on, that you came, and to hear about the kind of collateral effects of the study for treatment that was just sort of beyond cure. I think that was a really interesting contribution for us to think about justice and doing trials in certain populations. But I have a question, well, and so maybe for both of you, about enrollment of women who've just given birth into your trials. I've been involved in a different kind of screening study where it's just very hard for women who've just given birth to actually do an informed consent. I'm sure you understand exactly what I'm talking about. But so I'm wondering if you're following the ways that people who agree or decline to participate in your study, if you've got any kind of tracking for why they've declined, or do you have people who've declined, and what their understanding was, how this particularly really difficult period to approach women is affecting the consent process.
Well, the protocol just opened, and we have not yet enrolled a single patient.
Good opportunity for a social scientist to join your group.
Sorry, can I just to make a few points that you're absolutely correct. It's a very, very vulnerable time. And especially when the mother's diagnosed in labor for the first time, when she had no clue that HIV existed or that she would have it or a baby has it, it's very hard. And they need a lot of support. And, we try to give it to them, and our team are actually available for them. And the research is, it's kind of almost secondary, actually, which it is. But the importance is to get the infant onto treatment, but with lots of support. And part of the benefit of all the intense monitoring and visiting is that it actually is time to actually talk to the mother and support her, because they really need it. And, luckily our nurses and counselors and social worker are attuned to this. It's still not easy, but that is what's needed. And, we do know that.
And one other thing that we did to try to lessen the burden of informed consent for these newly diagnosed mothers in particular is that we have a step one consent form that just enrolls patients that are within 48 hours of birth, and a separate consent process for those that are demonstrated to be infected, which is much more complicated than just the first step of the study. So we've tried to simplify it a bit for the mothers who we all acknowledge are under a tremendous amount of stress.
Chintana.
Thank you. So I'd just like to address the question that you, Joe and John brought up, is that you said that the risk to these babies are very high getting triple therapy. But if you think about, like in Thailand, we have 1,000 babies who are born to mothers without prenatal care, or mother with high viral load, and the transmission risk in these babies is almost 10%. So if you had an adult who was exposed and had a risk of 10%, wouldn't you give them PEP? Three-drug PEP, and so we think of it as the benefit is just far outweigh the risk of being infected for the rest of your life. And so in Thailand, in effect, because of the Mississippi child and the evidence that the transmission risk is so high in these exposed babies, the Thai guideline has now changed and will give triple therapy to all babies who are born to mothers without prenatal care or mothers who have high viral load at time delivery. And we hope that this will bring down the transmission rate significantly, and actually we'll be measuring the reservoir in these babies as well. And hopefully in the future, we could have a protocol like P1115.
Thank you.
Quick comment on that, Sandy?
Sure.
So one interesting thing when we were working on this paper and thinking about the risks of this study is I was trying to talk to clinicians to figure out what's the standard of care. If you want to figure out the risks of the research, you compare it to what the standard of care is. And I got different answers from almost anyone I asked. Some people said 2 drugs for prophylaxis, some said 3. And it just generally gave me the sense that it's evolving, and the Mississippi baby reporting of this case is actually changing the standard of care. So I think that's also a really interesting challenge for measuring what the risks of this research are. And in some senses, the standard of care and the research start to converge, the risks go down.
Thank you. Back microphone, and I think that we're going to have to make that the last question unless somebody else has a really burning one, because I promised to keep us on time and we are between you and your lunch.
Okay, really quickly. That's some fire to my tail. So can you talk to me about the recruitment strategies and engagement strategies of the parents of these children? Basically, how do you get these infants into the studies that you're talking about? What has been effective? I hear you saying that, you know, things are just beginning, so perhaps you don't know that. But I'm wondering, how do you engage these parents of these infants, but then more specifically, infants of color? Here, I think the Mississippi baby presents some very unique set of circumstances that, you know, has informed the science here. But, you know, I'm thinking, generally speaking, how do you engage these infants? But then specifically, your strategies around infants of color.
Well, I think the step one is to notify care providers in all areas that could potentially enroll patients in the study and potentially for the greater good anywhere, so that care providers are aware of the potential benefit of limiting reservoir formation by early therapy. So most importantly, we have to make certain that the people at the sites that of high-risk deliveries are aware that there are possible interventions. And then obviously, speaking in a very appropriate, engaging, understanding, sympathetic manner with the mothers so that they understand what the risk and benefit are of participating in this kind of a trial is critically important, in particular because they are so vulnerable being peripartum. I don't know if anyone else wants to.
Just quickly, I think the language you used is very important, the question about engaging. And, you know, some people, I think, reflexively say, if somebody's vulnerable, we should exclude them from research. We just shouldn't expose them to the risks. But that also excludes them from potential benefits, and it also limits the generalizability of the research we're doing. So I think there's a lot of pressure on the informed consent process to achieve what you're suggesting, engagement with somebody who's going through a pretty difficult period. But if that can be achieved, then hopefully what we're doing is not just using vulnerability as a barrier that prevents people from engaging in research, but as some approach to helping them understand and access potential benefits.
Because engagement and recruitment are in fact different, at least in my mind. Process.
Yeah, I think there is an important place for community engagement in advance of the research, which can disseminate right. information and have broader input from the community. Sure. So there's that part. But I think the informed consent process also can be, if done well, a process of engagement.
I just want to make one comment and to say that mothers don't want their infants to become infected. And so this is on a spectrum of prevention. It's really one drug in the regimen that's different in terms of the dosing, and that's the nevirapine. Because in the standard setting, any kid born in the U.S. to a mom like the Mississippi child would receive AZT and nevirapine. And most experts, as Seema said, would use 3TC. So it's really the nevirapine dose, which is usually given 3 doses over the first 7 days of life, is being given twice daily for the first week to two until we can get results of nucleic acid testing. You know, as John pointed out earlier, this could really be facilitated by a point of care test. We can really truncate the exposure for infants who are not infected. Now, having said that, by using three drug combinations, these can really alter the performance characteristics of the tests because you need to have sufficient amount of infected cells for the standard clinical test to detect infection. So we may actually get to a point where it complicates diagnosis in these children because we've given them enhanced prophylaxis. But it is a protocol that's built around the expectations that these tests will change. We've used broad language with respect to nucleic acid testing, not specifying DNA or RNA or total nucleic acid. And the platforms will change and the protocol will have to change over the time course. And we face the same dilemmas in terms of what are the biomarkers to use to say whether a child should actually go off treatment. And our scenario is complicated by treatment at 6 to 8 weeks of age. If kids are effectively suppressed and controlled, most of them, it's actually hard to detect infection using standard DNA testing and antibody testing while they're on interventional treatment. So we do have to be careful with our messaging here to the community that if you test antibody negative and DNA negative and you're an HIV-infected child, that doesn't mean that you've been cured and you can go off treatment. What's different here is how early the kids are getting treatment. So we do expect this protocol to evolve as we learn more from each case, including consent issues and how to best do this. But the reason I started my presentation with the PMTCT agenda is that the pediatric community have extensive experience in consenting women during labor and delivery and post-delivery for use of antiretroviral drugs to prevent infection. And this is just one step beyond that.
And we will declare the morning session adjourned, and Veronica lunch is in the back. Thank you.